of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please take a seat. So, I enjoy me the occasional movie, or more than that. And I like action movies. I mean, partially I like them because they are totally unrealistic. And they're escapists. They're a moment of just not having to worry about anything. You get to watch some guy with a gun take out some other guy with a tank who's driving through a building and the whole place collapses. And it's amazing! I mean, it's not real. It's not real. and I don't think it is. There's no part of me that goes, ooh, I wish I had a tank so I could drive it through a building just to see. No. And part of the unrealism of those movies is the emotional content of usually the action hero. Bruce Willis, because Bruce Willis, and he comes out there and there is nothing that frightens that man in the movies, is there? I mean, he's in the middle of Russia and there's a tank and he's going to take it on driving a little Jeep or something. It's crazy. There is no fear in those people. And that is totally, totally unrealistic. That's part of the escapism. In the gospel reading, we have this really interesting interplay between fear, courage, and faith. So in those movies that I enjoy, courage is doing the brave thing. Courage is being fearless in the face of whatever, whoever the bad guys are. My problem with that is that it's bogus. It's good fun, but it's not real. Courage is something very different. Courage is being afraid and doing it, whatever it is. Courage is being bone weary and taking a couple of extra steps. Courage is not necessarily seeing how this might end and doing whatever it is anyway. That's real courage. Those guys in the movies, that's not real courage. It's awesome explosions. So fear and courage, they're not opposites. If you're not frightened, you can't be brave. Because bravery is courage, doing what you must or what you feel is right despite your fears. Faith is an interesting one. Jesus, and he's praying, and the disciples are out in the boat, and there's a bit of a storm whipping up, and they're anxious, they're nervous, maybe they're frightened, and Jesus comes walking across them, across the lake, and they freak out. And I've got to be honest, I don't blame them, because if I was in the middle of a lake, and someone decided to wander out to me, I would be just a little bit nervous at that moment. And can you imagine? And especially, it's a bit dark maybe. Some winds, clouds. Ah, it's a ghost. That would terrify me. No, don't blame me. Jesus says, take courage, it's me. Don't be afraid. And then Peter's response was really interesting. He says, Lord, if it is you, tell me to come. And Peter gets out of the boat and he starts to walk across the water. And then he gets frightened by the wind and he starts to sink. And Jesus reaches out a hand, lifts him back up and says, you didn't have enough faith, did you? Huggins, come on, get back in the boat. I'm paraphrasing. And the winds die down. What do we do with it? Last week I spoke about a little bit about struggling sometimes with the supernatural elements, and somebody walking across the water. Now, the healing miracles and the feeding miracles, in a sense, those are easy because they tell us what we should do. Jesus healed people. We should heal people. We might not have magic powers. Not that Jesus had magic powers, but you know what I mean. Jesus fed people. We should feed people. What do we do with this one? It's interesting that the way the disciples respond is by understanding that it is clearly a sign that Jesus is the Son of God. It is the control over the chaos of the world. And they remember Genesis chapter 1, and God speaks and draws order out of chaos, and water is a symbol of chaos. That's why in Genesis chapter 1, God's Spirit hovers over the waters. Waters are chaotic. They don't hold a nice, neat shape. If you're in the Middle East, it's not easy to carve yourself a block of water. Just water. So the disciples clearly understand that this is a sign that Jesus is God. Or at least, at the very least, has the authority of God. So what do we do? What do we do with that? Because that's the question I keep coming back to. Does it mean we should be like Bruce Willis in the action movies? God's on our side. I don't need to be afraid. I mean, I can't be courageous then because I've got nothing to... I don't think so. I don't think that's what it means at all. I think it means we should be courageous, but not frightened sometimes. And here's why. Because just like if you're not afraid, you can't be brave, you've got to be a little bit frightened to be a little bit brave. That's how it works. I believe you have to be just a little bit frightened to have a little bit of faith. Having faith when you have nothing to be concerned about is a luxury that's unused. And if you never use it, you might as well not have it. When I was smaller than I am now in junior school, I did gymnastics. I could do a cartwheel. I could do what we used to call a round off. It's like when you do a cartwheel in there with your feet together. And do you know how much use I've made of those skills? Very little. Separate story, I once nearly accidentally cartwheeled and kicked a principal in the head. You shouldn't show off at school. I didn't use them, I lost them. If faith is just a luxury that we can put on our bookshelf like a family heirloom and never need it, we might as well not have it. We need to be just a little bit frightened. Because that way we are reliant on God. Not to clean up all our problems. Not at all. But when things get a bit difficult, we know that God comes to us. When we are like the disciples on the lake and the storm is building up, we know that God comes to us. And we learn to live into that. Not to rely on, but to live into it. And if we live into it, then we can become models for others as to what a faith means. It doesn't mean we're never afraid. It doesn't mean we never have questions. What do we do with the supernatural? What do we do with the complications in the world? What do we do with the daily grind? What do we do with these things? We still have to negotiate those. But we do so with faith, confident that God comes to us in the storms of life. And that's when we can start to build a deeper and more profound relationship with God. When we know our faith. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.